Welcome to the webinar, Is Regression Hindering Your Progress? My objective in this webinar is to outline three interesting ideas and then present you three aids to help you smartly regress. New and incremental features are really the focus for revenue generation and market expansion, whereas bug fixes are necessary to ensure that customers stay. While on the path of progression towards revenue enhancement, the challenge is, did I break stuff that were working well? As the product grows, so does regression, increasing costs and threatening to slow down the releases. So what's the challenge of change? The challenge really is three things. What to retest, how to retest efficiently, and what not to retest. To answer and find out ways to address this challenge creatively, let's put together a simple model of what is testing and use this to test or retest smartly. Testing is really a Cartesian product of what you want to test, denoted on the x-axis, and test for what, denoted as various criteria to cleanliness on the y-axis. So the x-axis could represent the various elements of test. It could be a feature, a user story, a requirement, and so on. Whereas the y-axis really is various criteria. Criteria related to data and inputs, criteria related to the interface, criteria related to internal structure, the behavior of the individual features, correctness of the various business flows, you know, working on all the environments, the criteria related to various attributes, and finally, the working with the various other systems and deployment in real life. So let's expand as to what constitutes the what to test. What to test is really an entity, which could be at any level. It could be a basic building block, like a structural component. It could be a collection of components which kind of form a technical feature. Which could be a set of technical features which come together to form a business requirement. Or a set of requirements that a real end user uses, which is really the user flow. So what to test is really one of these entities under test, which can form really the x-axis. So what is test for what? So various criteria, as we mentioned. Criteria which could relate to, hey, you know, does it deploy well, or all the attributes are met? You know, could be performance attributes, security attributes, load handling attributes, and so on. Working on various environments, maybe browsers, maybe operating systems, maybe with different kinds of devices, and so on. Behavior attributes related to business flows, related to technical features. Internal aspects of the system, the internals, you know, the way it handles resources, the way it handles exceptions, and stuff like that. And finally, the lower level attributes in terms of the interface of the UI. It could be a GUI, it could be a messaging interface, it could be an API-based interface, and so on. And finally, the ability to handle data, ensuring that only good inputs are accepted. So really, this is the cleanliness criteria that we want to test for. So I guess we understand that it's just a Cartesian product, therefore, of what do you want to test and what do you want to test for. And therefore, regression testing can be seen as what to retest crossed with retest for what. And again, the same thing as before. Only thing is the entity is retested entity, or the criteria is retested criteria, meaning what of the entities should I retest? And for that entity, what should I retest for? Which of these cells should I focus? That's really what regression testing happens to be. So let's take this approach to come up with a smart approach to tackling the challenge of change. So what to retest is what may be the affected entities that need to be retested and what criteria of these entities are to be retested for. Second, before we go on into the second one, let's go a little more deeply into the first one. How do I do this? We talked about various types of entities, which I'm going to denote as different planes. This plane represents the structural component, whereas the last one represents the user flow. So whereas here, these y-axis represents the criteria, denoted as various levels of quality. I've only shown you four levels for simplicity here. In HBD, we have 8 levels. And I've just kind of shown you any entity, 4 of them here, which could be in this plane a structural component, in this plane it could be a feature, and so on. So, given the fact that this particular entity, let us say it is a structural component, has been modified, maybe I refactored the code to possibly improve the performance, or improve the security, or make it more robust by handling certain exceptions, whatever be it. So I want to be able to understand, if I change this piece of code, which is really a building block or a component, one of these, which is, let's say, entity E2, what should I retest? So given an entity, in this case a component that has been modified, first, what do? I analyze if this could affect any other of its criteria. So I kind of move vertically on this component to find out, hey, I modified the structural aspect of this code. Could it affect the interface? Could it affect any other criteria? That is step number one. Step number two, now analyze if this could affect any other entity, any other similar entity. Remember, this plane consists of all the software structural components. So we're trying to find out, hey, I modified this component. Could it affect something else? And if so, which level? That's the kind of a thought process that's outlined in step number two. Step number three goes on the z-axis. And this is really asking, okay, I modified this component, so which of the features could it possibly affect? And which of the business requirements that it is belonging to could be affected? And so on. Same logic. We move along the x-axis to kind of nail down which of the features and what criteria of that feature should I check? Is it just the behavior, or should I check the performance aspect of it, and so on? So what we have here is using this model of what to test and test for what. Across these four planes, we could use these steps aids as 1, 2, and 3, moving along the axis of X and Y and Z, and go through a little more systematic scientific way to identify what to retest. And what is the objective? We want to be as optimal as possible, because retesting does consume effort and time unless it's fully automated. So let's, having answered the first question of the challenge of change, let's move on to the second one. So what do we call this? We call this as fault propagation analysis in the hypothesis-based testing methodology, or HPT. Let me now outline what I just mentioned as an aid. And I'm going to call this as aid number one, fault propagation analyzer, which really states that we want to assess the fault propagation level-wise within an entity, that is number one, this direction, across the entities, this direction and this direction. So we move across Y, we move across X, and we move across Z. And these are outlined as 3 steps. So this is possibly an interesting aid that could be used to help us analyze the fault propagation. Now let's go to the second one. How do I retest efficiently? Well, automating execution is most useful here. The only challenge is the scripts need to be in sync with the scenarios, because as software changes, scenarios might get added or modified or updated. So it's important that this script needs to be in constant sync with. To enable this, what HPD recommends is ensuring that the scenarios are segregated by the levels so that the scripts are shorter and maintainable. What does this mean? Let's go down. Given test scenarios or cases for an entity does a wide variety of validations. For example, a scenario if, for example, if it validates the boundaries of data inputs, it also validates certain formats of acceptance of inputs in terms of a UI or a data format, the order, for example. Or if it also does validations, hey, does it work on different environments? And in additionally, of course, the behavior, then it's like a big blob. This scenario is like a big blob, which does a wide variety of stuff. So what we are recommending as part of HPT is to levelize them, to split them into various levels. What is a level? Remember this picture? Level one is inputs are clean, the criteria related to the handling of data. Level two is all about criteria related to the acceptance of inputs via the various interfaces and so on. So given if this scenario or the set of test cases that form a scenario is a bigger blob, levelize them by segregating them into quality levels so that we can automate these individual scenarios. What does this mean? Scripts are smaller, they're simpler, and therefore they're more maintainable. And therefore, we could possibly ensure that the scripts are always in sync. So putting this idea together as an aid number two is the automation fitness analyzer. And all it is trying to do is, hey, before I jump on and automate anything, I just want to be sure that my test cases are well structured to enable rapid automation and maintenance. And all it says is, again, these three things. Number one, if it's well structured into levels, then the test cases are very focused and indeed they're very fit. If the test cases are kind of mixed, meaning they do data validation, they do interface validation, they do structural, certain aspects of structural validation like memory leaks and so on. They also do behavior validation, that's these four levels. Then maybe the system test kind of includes a bit of dev test also, and therefore it could be a longer script, maybe more brittle and higher maintenance. So maybe you should rethink. It may not be the most fit for automation. The three is really number two, but then the levels are on the higher levels. That is, the test cases at levels 4 to 7 are mixed up. That means it is validating features and flows and attributes, and therefore it does a lot more at the higher level. And again, the same issue. It is possibly a little difficult, making more harder to automate. So what do? We segregate them into quality levels to ensure that they can be automated easily, ensuring that scripts are simple and maintainable. So with that, we've talked about two of the challenges. Let's address the final challenge, what not to pretest. We all know as testing progresses, test cases don't uncover defects. So that is, the rate of defects fall down with time, because we run this kind of the same test case, right? So what is suggested here as a smart way of thinking is, hey, do you track the test case that do not yield the defects, so that I may avoid executing them? That is what we're trying to do by measuring the notion of yield. So if I find issues or don't find issues, what I'm trying to do is I'm going to track test cases that do not yield the defects per cycle. Maybe I could segregate the yield by levels. I could say, you know, level 6 bugs and level 5 bugs, level 4 bugs, or level 4 test cases, level 5 bug test cases, level 6 test cases by various cycles. And then kind of normalize, hey, I have got 100 test cases at level 4, which basically validates the feature, out of which maybe, let's say, 20 of them never found an issue. With time, the 20 became 15, it became 10, it became 5, and so on, and therefore the yield kind of dropped. So what does this tell you? It tells you yield as a normalized number of defects per test case is dropping. So once we get this yield, we kind of look at which are the test cases that have been consistently passing, and therefore understand that particular part of the system is hardened. Maybe it's that feature, maybe it's that flow, maybe it's the performance aspect of the business flow, and it's hardened, and therefore maybe we can avoid testing. Unless, of course, it's completely automated, in which case we don't bother too much, as it doesn't cost a lot of effort to be wasted. And therefore, putting this idea is what we can come up with, the yield analyzer, the yield number three. How is the test yield over time? And what's the yield? Basically, a ratio of the outcome to effort, that is the number of defects to executed test cases. And all we're trying to do is to normalize this and put this by levels. So we know some levels are hardened up and some levels are not so hardened up. And maybe we can now figure out which of these test cases I need to execute. Or put differently, not to execute. Again, the same notion of levels is the backdrop of how we end up using this. So in summary, the smart approach to tackling the challenge of change is to answer these three questions in a very smart way by using a well-formed logic. And that is, what to retest? The aid of use is fault propagation analysis. How to retest efficiently? The aid is automation analysis. And what not to retest? Perform yield analysis using the yield analyzer aid, which is what I've summarized as these three aids for smart regression. We conducted a short survey a few days ago. We had about 50 responses, and the questions were fairly simple. What fraction of total testing effort do your regression tests consume? So if you really look, about less than 10% said, less than 10%. The red, which denotes about 10 to 40, said about 50%. So it does simply indicate that we do spend, unfortunately, a significant amount of time as a fraction of the total effort to regression testing. And therefore, it is a good case for optimization using technology in terms of automation and smarter ways of doing things. And therefore, when we came to the second question of what fraction of regression test cases are automated, it's interesting. About a third of them said it's less than 25. About a third of them said it's about 25 to 50. And about a third of them said it's about 50%. So just about a third of them seem to have a much more significant amount of automation in place. Whereas, the least minimum is 25%. So most certainly 25% is indeed automated, for sure, at least. So there is a lot of effort that we are putting in place as an organization, as a community, to focus on automation, which is very much natural. So now let's ask the third question. Hey, what's the yield? And what did people say? About 37%, a little over a third, said it's less than 5%. And the red one, which is about 5 to 20%, is about less than two-thirds. It's about 60-odd%. So what it simply means is the regression yield, at the best case, is largely 20%. So about 80% of these issues, 80% of the test cases don't yield. So is there a scope for optimization? Looks like, isn't it? Because, one, a lot of test cases don't yield. And that's what we expect. We expect, hopefully, the product matures with time, which is a good sign, actually. And the last and final question is, I think that the smarter assessment of how to regress could reduce the regression effort by, and we were like, I was asking an open question, do you think there is benefit in considering a smarter way of doing things? And if you looked at it, the orange and the red, which is the 10 to 25% and 25 to 50% is what people said. So, about 20% of the people said, maybe 10% improvement. That means not very high. But about a third of the people said, yes, it could be anywhere between 10 to 25%. And about half of them said, well, it's really 25 to 50%. So what it simply means is people do believe that there is a significant amount of scope for smarter regression as an aid to reducing the effort. And about a 50% of them feel it could be anywhere between about a quarter to a half reduction, which is very interesting. So, before I conclude with the last slide, I'll leave you with a little limerick that I wrote on regression testing. And it reads like this: everything was fine until I modified a line. It opened a hidden door, spilling bugs all over the floor. Now I very carefully regress, automating test of every part, and doing less by being smart so as not to impede progress.